Steve Jones was and still is about the tightest lead guitarist I've ever heard in my life. This is Steve's basic rhythm guitar, sort of what he would play live. Nice sort of chuggy rhythm. But he also did slightly different versions of the rhythm. Adding accents to it.
You know, like the fact that like a bit of feedback comes in on one verse and then like something else comes in on another. And the whole thing of, you know, just the initial track that went down on the guitar, then that would be copied on the right-hand side, you know, so that it wasn't stereo, it was like mono deluxe.
Bring the drums in, you'll hear how tight Steve is. And bass. Now you hear there's two or three versions of the solo guitar here. How about a bit of Johnny?
And then we cut Anarchy in the UK and we cut that on the third take. And it was like, oh, this is better.
Did the Wessex Studios, the first time I clearly heard myself and did not recognise it. I had no idea it was that much of a honky-donky.
I'm sure that's how he got his vocal styles, to get the most racket out of not being able to hear himself, you know.
I mean, he's no crooner, but... His diction and delivery are fantastic.
He had a melody about him as well. People said he couldn't sing, but, you know, he came up with a lot of the melody on the songs.
Anarchy for the UK, yeah, it's coming sometime, maybe, yeah.
And you can see how I can sit him in the track without covering the lyric, really.
Berlin was fun in a weird way because of the wall and gawping at the Russians, and I liked it, and a song automatically came straight out of it, the paranoia of the place.
To start with, I think we tried to sort of incorporate some of Sid's bass, you know, for his sake, really. But I think by the end we gave up even doing that.
We played on bodies. We tried to sort of shove something sort of subsonic, sort of just like the sort of bit underneath the actual record on God Save the Queen. But I mean, I think by the time it was cut, that didn't even exist.
Well, Sid was in the band, but he couldn't really play, and thank God, when we was doing Nevermind the Bollocks, he was in hospital with yellow jaundice, and he was out of it.
We were stuck. All we had was, like, Steve with the guitar and Paul on the drums.
And the recording technique we started was to have Steve Jones playing his basic rhythm guitar and Paul Cook playing drums. We'd have been sitting there listening to something like this. Steve would then build up his rhythm guitars. And then add some overdubs.
But when we just had like two instruments, just drums and guitar, it was like they put it down and you couldn't hear anything wrong with it particularly. They were just sort of doing what they always did. So I thought, well, let's get Steve to try the bass on it. you know, like, just to sort of have some idea of like where we were going and what we were going to do.
And the very last thing Steve would do would be to put his bass on the bottom underneath all of his guitars.
Got to set it straight that Chris Spedding actually played all the guitar on Never Mind the Bollocks. And I don't even know what studio they did it in.
Steve did everything, you know. He did the bass, he did the guitars, he did the lot, you know. And nobody really... You still read somewhere, Chris Spedding, Sex Pistols session player or something. Like,
first few shows, he was behind the curtain playing it as well, live. So I'll thank you for that, Chris.
And then, finally... Time for Johnny's lead vocal.
And Steve just like put this part on that was just like, he's just playing exactly the same thing as he plays on the guitar, but like on the octave down. And bingo, that was it. That was what really people consider to be the Sex Pistols sound. That whole thing of having like an E bar chord, the octave below that, that's the whole thing, you know. It's just like Panzer division, it's just like